Okay, good morning everyone and welcome to JFD's weekly market outlook webinar for the week February 17th until February 21st. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will describe the most important economic releases and events on the financial agenda for the week ahead. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer first. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into the market. Okay, the main events on this week's agenda are the Eurozone's flash PMIs. I have them first on the list, although they are coming on Friday, because I believe it's the most important indicator. They are the most important indicators as investors are trying to figure out whether or they are looking for clues on how the coronavirus has affected the euro area economy. We also have the UK and Canada CPIs this week, which may well shape expectations with regards to Bank of England and Bank of Canada policy moves moving ahead. We have the Australia Wage Price Index for quarter four and the Australian Employment Report for January. Again, for clues on how the RBA may move forward. And we also get the RBA, the ECB, and the FOMC meeting minutes. Okay, but let's start with today. Today is likely to be a relatively light day with no major economic indicators on the European and US agendas. After all, markets in the US and Canada will be closed in celebration of Washington's birthday and the family day respectively. The only important data set we had was already released during the Asian morning, and this was Japan's GDP for the fourth quarter. The quarter-over-quarter rate slumped to -1.6% from +0.1%, and this dragged the year-over-year rate down to -6.3% from +0.5%. And this makes the biggest year-over-year fall since 2014. Now, with the uncertainty over the impact of the coronavirus outbreak casting shadows over the nation's economic performance for the first quarter of 2020, it seems that Japan looks to be headed towards a recession. Remember that a recession is two consecutive quarters marked with negative growth. Now, talking about the coronavirus, the number of cases accelerated somewhat on Monday. You can see the graph here that the blue line of cases is slightly fractionally above zero. Remember that on these graphs, anything above zero shows acceleration and anything below zero shows a slowdown. However, this was the first acceleration after 2 days marked by a slowdown. You can see that for 2 days, Saturday and Sunday, we had a slowdown in the number of cases. The number of deaths has also started to slow. You can see that the deaths are clearly, the percentage change of deaths on a daily basis is clearly below zero, marking a slowdown. And this happened as Chinese authorities tightened further restrictions in Hubei, with most vehicles banned from the streets, while firms were told to stay closed until further notice. On top of that, China's central bank, the People's Bank of China, cut interest rates on its medium-term lending today, a move targeted to ease further the drag to businesses from the virus. Now, due to that, most Asian indices traded in the green following China's efforts to contain the fast-spreading virus. but Japan's Nikkei was one of the exceptions. It came under some selling interest after the slump in Japan's GDP for the last quarter of 2019. Now, on Tuesday, during the Asian morning, we get the minutes from the latest RBA policy meeting, where the bank decided to keep interest rates unchanged at 0.75%, as was widely expected. That said, the statement accompanying the decision was less dovish than anticipated, with officials noting that the bushfires and the coronavirus outbreak will weigh on the domestic economy only temporarily. With regards to interest rates, they repeated that the long and variable lags in the transmission of monetary policy allowed them to keep rates steady at that meeting, although they remained prepared to ease further if needed. Having all this in mind, we will scan the minutes to see how comfortable officials are on the sidelines, but what may be more determinant on how the bank may proceed moving ahead may be the wage price index and the employment report, which we get on Wednesday and Thursday, respectively. Now, during the European morning of Tuesday, we get the UK employment report for December. The unemployment rate is forecast to have held steady at its 45-year low of 3.8%, while average weekly earnings, including bonuses, are expected to have slowed to 3% year-over-year from 3.2%. The excluding bonuses rate is anticipated to have ticked down to 3.3% from 3.4%. According to the IHS Market, KPMG and REC report on jobs for the month, this is a monthly report, a monthly survey that comes out ahead of the official UK employment data. So according to this report, starting salaries for both permanent and temporary staff accelerated somewhat from November's lows, which suggests that the risks surrounding the earnings may be tilted somewhat to the upside. So there is a chance we see accelerating earnings instead of slowing ones, as the forecast suggests. Accelerating wages may be a welcome development for Bank of England policymakers and may alleviate some pressure for cutting rates. But as we noted in the past, our view is that they may place more emphasis on data pointing to how the economy has been performing in the post-election era before they decide how to move forward. After all, they clearly pointed out at the latest meeting that they will wait for data to confirm the positive signals from recent indicators, with inflation taking the first place on the list. Thus, we expect Wednesday's CPIs and Thursday's retail sales for January to attract much more attention than the employment data. Now, from January, we have the ZEW survey for February. The current conditions index is expected to have slid slightly further into the negative territory to minus 10 from minus 9.5, and this would mark the seventh straight month with a negative sign. The economic sentiment index is also expected to have declined to 22 from 26.7. So this data may reveal how the coronavirus has affected sentiment in Eurozone's economic powerhouse and may be an early omen with regards to which direction Friday's PMIs may come in. Now let's move on to Wednesday. On Wednesday, Asian time, we get Australia's wage price index for the fourth quarter, and expectations are for the index to have held steady at 2.2% year over year. However, with headline inflation ticking up to 1.8% during the quarter, this means that real wages may have slowed. You can see here that inflation has been rising somewhat, steadily, but has been rising, while wages have been steady or lower. This makes the real wage growth, which is wages minus inflation, to slow down. You can see that we have three consecutive quarters of a slowdown in real wages. So If Australia's wages stay at 2.2, we may have a further slowdown in real earnings. So this may not be a slowdown in real wages may not be a so pleasant development for RBA policymakers, although the wage price index will just be stable. Now, early in the EU session, we get Sweden's inflation data for January. Both the CPI and CPIF rates are expected to have ticked down to 1.7% and 1.6% from 1.8 and 1.7 respectively. That said, we repeat for the umpteenth time that we will pay more attention to the core CPIF rate, which excludes the volatile items of energy. In December, that rate ticked down to 1.7 from 1.8. At its latest meeting, the Riksbank acknowledged that falling energy prices are expected to dampen inflation this year, but it expects the headline rate to be close to the 2% target afterwards. Thus, a modest slowdown in the headline rate is unlikely to tempt officials to alter their forward guidance, which suggests that the repo rate is expected to remain at 0% during almost the entire forecast horizon. That said, a notable slide in the core CPIF rate, which excludes energy, may raise concerns that the weakness in inflation may not be due to falling energy prices. This could raise speculation that officials may start rethinking their current policy stance, and thereby this could prove negative for the Swedish krona. An hour later, all eyes will be on the UK CPIs for January. The headline rate is expected to have risen to 1.6% year over year from 1.3%, while the core rate is forecast to have ticked up to 1.5% from 1.4%. Having said that, though, bearing in mind that the year over year change in Brent oil turned negative in January, and you can see that here, the black dotted line is the year over year change in Brent oil, which tracks relatively well the spread between the headline and the core CPI rates. Remember, I'm repeating that the difference between the headline and the core CPI rates is due to volatile items like food and energy. And that's why I have the year-over-year change in WTI here. So it's as a gauge of the CPI spread. So with a negative year-over-year change in Brent oil, if core inflation is set to accelerate, the headline rate may rise by less than anticipated. In any case, a move in the desired direction may allow Bank of England policymakers to hold their fingers away from the cut button for a while, especially after the resignation of Sajid Javid as finance minister, which sparked hopes of more fiscal support. According to the CME MPC Sonia futures, and 25 basis points decrease from the Bank of England is nearly fully priced in for the November gathering. Here we have the forthcoming the months with upcoming Bank of England meetings, and you can see that a 25 basis point cut is nearly fully priced in for November. This is the bank's current rate, and this is the rate after a quarter point cut. Now we get more January CPIs later in the day, and this time from Canada. The headline CPI is expected to have risen to 2.4% from 2.2, while the core rate is anticipated to have ticked up to 1.8% from 1.7%. Using again the logic that energy prices are somewhat correlated with the spread between the headline and the core rates, the fact that the year-over-year change in WTI turned negative in January may not allow the headline inflation to accelerate that much. At its previous gathering, the Bank of Canada removed from the statement the part saying that it is appropriate to maintain the current level of interest rates, and instead noted that in determining the future path of the bank's policy rate, the governing council will be watching closely to see if there is a slowdown in growth is more persistent than forecast. This means that officials have opened the door to a rate cut, with Governor Polos confirming that at the press conference following the decision. So even if headline inflation does not accelerate as expected, as long as it stays above 2%, it may allow Bank of Canada officials to stay away from the cut button, especially following January's better than expected employment report. Now, flying from Canada to the US, we will on Wednesday we will get the FOMC, the minutes from the latest FOMC gathering. The message we got from that gathering was that policymakers are not comfortable with inflation persistently under their 2% target, and with the core PCE rate staying below that objective since December 2018, they may start thinking about rate cuts again if this continues for more. At the press conference, Fed Chair Powell said that policy is not in a preset course, and also acknowledge the risks the coronavirus poses to the US economy, something he also did when he testified before Congress last week. Although Powell insisted while testifying that rates are appropriate at current levels for now, we will scan the minutes to see whether and how many of his colleagues are on the same page and how many have already started thinking about lower rates again. According to the Fed Fund futures, the Fed Funds futures, investors are still pricing in another cut to be delivered in September, despite the December dot plot pointing to no action this year, and despite the better than expected employment and CPI data for January. Here I have again the yields of the Fed Fund futures. Current rate, the rate if we get a cut by 25 basis points, and you can see that such a move is priced in for September. Now moving to Thursday. On Thursday, Australia releases its employment data for January. The unemployment rate is expected to have rebounded back to 5.2% from 5.1%, while the net change in employment is expected to reveal a slowdown in added jobs to 10,000 from 28,900 in December. Combined with the declining real wage growth and unemployment rate still well above the 4.5% threshold, which the RBA believes it will start generating inflationary pressures, may prompt market participants to bring forth the timing of when they anticipate another rate decrease by the bank, despite officials signaling at their latest meeting that they are comfortable on the sidelines. According to the ASX 30-day interbank cash rate futures implied yield curve, market participants are almost pricing in another quarter point decrease by the RBA to be delivered in September. You can see the graph here, that and 25 basis points decrease is almost fully priced in for September. Now, later in the day, during the EU session, we get the UK retail sales for January. Headline sales are expected to have increased 0.5% month over month after sliding 0.6% in December. That said, this will drive the year over year rate down to 0.7% from 0.9%. The core rate is also forecast to have rebounded. Specifically, it is expected to have increased to 0.8% month over month from minus 0.8% the month before, but the year-over-year core rate is anticipated to have slid to 0.7% year-over-year from 0.7. The case for lower year-over-year rates is also supported by the BRC retail sales monitor, the year-over-year of which declined to 0% from 1.7%. That said, at this point, I need to know that the BRC monitor is far from a reliable gauge of the official retail sales prints. Taking data from back January 2011, the correlation between the BRC monitor and the official headline year-over-year rate is only 0.26. The correlation with the core rate is also low at 0.29. Now, in any case, despite the potential slide in the year-over-year rates, a rebound in monthly terms could allow investors to push further back the timing of when they expect a rate cut by the Bank of England. The minutes from the latest ECB meeting are also coming out on Thursday. At that meeting, the bank kept its rates and guidance unchanged. Thus, all the attention fell to the bank's strategic review, with President Lagarde noting that the aim will be reviewed, as well as the bank's toolkit and how inflation is measured. How we measure inflation is clearly something we need to look at, she noted. This will be key for market participants trying to figure out how the bank will act moving forward, as it may also result in a change in the inflation target. For example, officials could signal commitment to the 2% rate, as most of the other major central banks. Remember that the target of the ECB now is below but close to 2%, not exactly at 2%. So if they signal commitment to the 2% rate, this would mean more stimulus for hitting that goal, as any undershooting may not be dealt with the same tolerance as in the past. So we will dig into the minutes for further clues on that front. But given that the review is expected to be completed in November, we don't expect market participants to start betting on further easing as early as in the next couple of months, only due to potentially dovish minutes. Despite Lagarde adding that the bank would stick to its current policy for now, which means that policy moves could still occur before a new strategy is adopted. In our view, we believe that investors will pay more attention to Friday's PMIs, as they are eager to find out whether and how much did the coronavirus impacted the euro area economic outlook. And moving to Friday, during the Asian morning, Japan releases its national CPIs for January. The headline rate is forecast to have ticked down to 0.7% from 0.8, while the core one is anticipated to have ticked up to 0.8 from 0.7%. Bearing in mind that both the headline and core Tokyo CPIs for the month slid to 0.6 and 0.7 from 0.9 and 0.8 respectively, we view the risks surrounding the national forecasts as tilted to the downside. At its previous meeting, the Bank of Japan kept its ultra-loose policy unchanged, as well as its forward guidance, reiterating that it expects short and long-term interest rates to remain at their present or lower levels, as long as it is necessary to pay close attention to the possibility that the momentum towards achieving the price stability target will be lost. A slowdown in inflation combined with today's disappointing GDP prints may encourage investors to add to bets with regards to additional easing. However, similarly with the ECB, we believe that with little room for doing so, officials may prefer to wait for the picture to worsen significantly before they eventually decide to act. As for the yen, we don't expect a major reaction due to the CPIs. Given its safe haven status, we expect it to stay hostage to developments surrounding the broader market sentiment and especially headlines surrounding the fast spreading coronavirus. And during the European morning, the spotlight is likely to turn to the preliminary PMIs from several Eurozone nations and the bloc as a whole. As we already noted, we may get a first taste on how the virus may have affected the bloc from the German ZEW survey, which comes out tomorrow, but investors may rely more on what the PMIs will show for the whole euro area. The manufacturing PMI is forecast to have stayed in contractionary territory for the 13th month in a row, sliding to 47.5 from 47.9. The services index is also forecast to have slid, but to still signal expansion. Specifically, it is expected to have declined to 52.2 from 52.5. All this will drive the composite index down to 51 from 51.3. At the press conference following the latest ECB decision, President Lagarde repeated that the risks to the economic outlook are still tilted to the downside, but less pronounced, as surveys and data still point to some stabilization. So a modest slide in the PMIs is unlikely to make her change that view, but a larger than expected decline may raise concerns over the impact of the virus on the bloc's economy and could add further pressure to the already wounded euro, as some investors may start betting on more rate cuts by the ECB. That said, our own view is that given the bank's limited scope for further easing, officials may not rush into doing so, even if the PMIs disappoint. After all, an extension of the euro's latest tumble may eventually prove somewhat supportive for the bloc's economy, as it may be a helping hand for inflation and exports. Although the ECB has clearly stated several times that it does not target the exchange rate, a lower euro may be a welcome development for policymakers and may alleviate some pressure for additional stimulus, at least in the coming months. Now, we also get Eurozone's final CPIs for January, but as it is always the case, they are expected to confirm their initial estimates, namely that the headline CPI rate ticked up to 1.4% from 1.3%, and that the core one slid to 1.1 from 1.3. We get preliminary PMIs for February from the UK as well, but no forecasts are currently available. And later in the day, we will get even more PMIs, this time from the US. The preliminary market manufacturing index is forecast to have declined to 51.5 from 51.9, while the services one is anticipated to have held steady at 53.4. There is no forecast for the composite index, but in any case, market participants tend to pay more attention to the ISM PMIs, which are scheduled to be released on March 2nd and 4th. Now, from Canada, we get retail sales for December, with the headline rate anticipated to have fallen to 0.2% month over month from 0.9%, and the core one to have risen to 0.4% from 0.2%. Despite a potential slowdown in headline sales, a rising core rate conditional upon accelerating inflation on Wednesday may distance further Bank of Canada policymakers from the easing button. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. I hope you have a great week, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again next Monday. If you are interested in more detailed and frequent analysis, you can find me on our YouTube channel from Tuesday to Friday at around 8:30 a.m. GMT time. So, goodbye to you all, and have a very nice and great day.